Hello and welcome to the webinar with the team Applied Geomorphology and Territorial Planning. Allow me to introduce myself. I am Mihaela Verga. I am professor at the Faculty of Geography, University of Bucharest, and I have a professional background in geomorphological studies and research. For the next 2 or 3 hours, we will discover together in which way the geomorphological knowledge and applications can influence our lives for better or for worse. However, I will not conduct this virtual seminar only by myself, but I will have the support of my colleague Andrea Andratopurcianu, professor at the same faculty. Before I start, I want to draw your attention to the rules to be followed for a successful meeting. First of all, I kindly ask you to keep your camera and microphones off. Being a WebEx event, as far as I know, you can't turn this on, but anyway, please don't even try. Q&A section is available during this meeting for questions and comments. Also, from time to time, you are invited to participate in different polls related to the discussed subjects. Please note that neither your answer or your personal data won't be a subject or of further studies or statistical analysis. The sole purpose for these questionnaires is to establish a minimum conditioning communication between us, given this state, given this under these conditions, and to help us to adjust the discussion in line with the interest shown in your answer. Also, please note that this meeting is recorded. At the beginning, I want to ask you kindly to proceed for the first poll in order to give us at least essential information about your education, training, and field of interest. Please proceed. You will have 3 minutes for that. Thank you. Okay, the poll is now closed. So as far as I can see, most of you are a student at geography or geology, so, and you expect to improve your knowledge about this subject. So I hope I will have answers for this expectation. Reading this quote of Aristotle, that nature does nothing uselessly, I wonder how relief can be useful for us. That's why the presentation will be structured in two parts, a theoretical discussion about the meaning of applied geomorphology and the role of this kind of knowledge in spatial planning strategy design. The second part will consist in showing some practical exercises in two different projects of territorial development, which implies geomorphological analysis. Geomorphology is fundamental to environmental analysis, as it represents the main parameters of land spatial configuration, and also this science facilitates the relief's understanding. During this lecture, the essential aspect of applied geomorphology will be highlighted, such as the meaning and definitions attributed to this science, its concerns about the spatial configuration of terrestrial reliefs, trends of evolution, direct or indirect methods, such as cartographical three-dimension models, useful tools and techniques, and no less the role of applied geomorphology for planning and management of natural spaces. At this point, I would like to draw your attention to a short movie. I'm not sure it will be very, sorry, just a moment. I'm not sure if it has a proper quality, but please accept this. And now I will kindly ask you to proceed for the second poll, which is now opened. We have also 3 minutes to give the answer. There are still 8 poles in progress, so we must wait to finish. Okay. The majority of you consider that it's about a landslide, and the causes are combined, and the protection, the better protection, the best protection, the goodest protection is to build in areas without vulnerabilities. So let's find, let's see the correct answer and if it's converged with yours. As you can see, this event was the subject of some press report at that time. The New York Times tell us about a peculiar landslide that occurs in the northern part of Norway, in an area where such phenomena didn't happen before. At least not in the last 5 or 6 decades. So what do we know about this phenomenon by reading and watching the news? We can identify the project, the process, which was a landslide. So we know that the subject is related to the dynamic of terrestrial surfaces. That means dynamic of relief. There are information about the place on Earth affected by. And also, we are informed about the dimension of mass movement, totally unusual for that area, and direct and immediate consequences for community of people who used the land for its recreational function. More important is what we need to know in the way to avoid to be affected by such natural phenomena. Questions like, what are the causes of this kind of processes? When and how they happen? How big it will be? What can we do to inhibit or prevent them? Are often demand deeper consideration and scientific answers. But who are the specialists who can provide argued answer to these questions? The list of sciences involved in dealing with such problems is comprehensive, as you can see. Whether there are earth sciences, social sciences, or technical sciences. But an integrated approach to a specific practical problems induced by natural space dynamic, which affect its absorption capacity in terms of optimal relationship between natural space and humankind, it is the responsibility of applied geomorphology. What about the place and the role of applied geomorphology among other science involved seemingly in the same field of interest? As we can see, geomorphology has the same root word such as geology and geography, both of them considered earth sciences. It may seem that both are preoccupied by the earth's surface, but each science has an analysis perspective on its own. Geology involves the investigation of landscapes which have undergone radical changes in the remote past of the Earth, whereas geography is concerned with current landscapes genetically linked to the action of external forces, such as solar energy, water, air masses. So both sciences, geology and geography, are involved in knowledge and understanding of terrestrial surfaces configuration. But one emphasizes from inside and another one from outside. As an interface between the mentioned earth sciences, geomorphology's main area of study is the contact surface between the lithosphere on the one hand and the atmosphere and hydrosphere on the other hand. Thus, geology aims to study and interpret landforms and especially the causes that create and modify them in terms of geomorphic processes. However, since the land needed for human subsistences requires direct involvement of relief, the increased interaction between landforms and society have led to a specialization of geomorphology focused on relationship between terrestrial relief and humankind. This science was named by Tricart in 1962 and afterwards by Verstappen as applied geomorphology, the science of practical benefit. Many other researchers have dealt with pragmatism of geomorphology in the discussion of various applications of this knowledge. They use terms like environmental geomorphology, engineering geomorphology, or even engineering geology. Let's see how each term is described and defined. The first definition of applied geomorphology is given by the Tricart that I mentioned in 1962. He says that applied geomorphology occurred when men realized that the relief is an essential element of the environment in which he lives, but that is not immutable. On the contrary, it is the subject to slow development, and from one time to another, some paroxysms are expressed by catastrophic events, floods, volcano eruption, large land movements, and so on. Applied geomorphology is a field of science where research outcomes provide information about geomorphic landforms or processes that may be concerned to society, and where relevant, provide solution to problems of geomorphic context. There is a more recent definition given by Kimberly Mason. We also can say that applied geomorphology is an application of techniques and analysis to the solution of planning environmental management, engineering, or similar problems. Or also we can say that applied geomorphology offers solution of miscellaneous problem, especially to the development of resources and the mitigation hazards. On other hand, environmental geomorphology was defined by Coates and afterward by Panizza. According to Coates, environmental geomorphology is the practical use of geomorphology for the solution of problems where man wishes to transform landforms or to use and change superficial processes. Later, Panizza said that environmental geomorphology is defined as that area of earth sciences which examines the relationship between man and environment from geomorphological point of view. While engineering geomorphology represents the response to active relationship between infrastructure and morphodynamics, as Cavallin and their collaboratory says. We can conclude that even all three concepts aim to study the relationship between geomorphic system and society, applied geomorphology examines the link on both directions, from relief to man and vice versa, whereas environmental geomorphology and engineering geomorphology focuses solely on one-way conditioning relationship, either the effect of land use upon relief or the solution to the problem caused by the relief dynamic. So applied geomorphology is the practical use of geomorphological knowledge to have an effective spatial planning with more benefits and less costs, and to solve the impact of land use, resource exploitation, environmental management, and territorial planning problems. We established that the applied geomorphology may be defined as geomorphology in the service of man. There is a long history of such services, because every use made of land is influenced by the form of the ground, its associated materials, and its process of development. Hence, man has adapted to that form and exploited his knowledge on its natural process relationship. Archaeological records from around the world indicate that human occupation began about 8,000 years ago, and that agriculture and pastoralism were important activities for early civilization, which improved the land features precisely for that purpose. At any given time, the properties of physical environment provide absolute constraint or favorability on the types of land use. For example, the original location of towns and cities were commonly determined by geomorphological features, including fords for crossing rivers, coastal and estuarine inlets providing shelter for harbors, and entrance to upland places that had military or commercial advantages. From ancient time, the defense needs result in elevated town city sites or sites protected by river and marshes. In the modern age, the intersection of major valleys have traditionally been growth points for transport networks and larger towns. Adapting the configuration of the valleys to the needs of society was the subject of some early hydrotechnical improvements, as dams, gabions, or wooden fences. To the present day, smaller settlements are normally positioned in geomorphological advantages sites, such as better drain. Nowadays, the application of geomorphic knowledge to problem solving spans all the classic traditions of geomorphology and is useful for human environmental solution across a broad range of regions, including coastal shoreline erosion control, landslide risk assessment, and dam-related river management issue. The main objective of applied geomorphology, according to Tricard, is, quote, to convince those who study, plan, or build the works of man in the landscape about the necessity to include morphological processes in their consideration if they want to understand their subject. Coates take up the idea by claiming that geomorphology as an applied study should study the geomorphological processes and terrain in the way to identify what kind of geomorphological components affect man, analysis of problems in areas where man plans to disturb or has already degraded the land, man's utilization of geomorphic agents or product as a resource such as water, sand, gravel, or land forms, and finally, the use of geomorphology in territorial planning and environmental management. Panica associate applied geomorphology with environmental geomorphology and highlights the relationship between human activities and environment in the geomorphological point of view. He had divided the geomorphological components into geomorphological research, geomorphological resources and geomorphological hazards. Geomorphological resources includes landforms and deposits, both of which are or may become useful for man. Geomorphological hazards related to the geomorphic processes can induce instability in a specific area. In these two examples, both geomorphological components are shown. For instance, mountain rocks become important, economically valuable, when it's used for mining activity. Also, the mountain landscape and landforms could become valuable for tourism. A fluvial terrace offers suitable construction surfaces being horizontally. In the same time, this horizontal surface is linked to the riverbank erosion, which created, and other associated slippery processes that may alter or destroy buildings and infrastructure due to the rapid degradation of the slope. As we can see in the image, the one construction is already affected, and also one tree has collapsed because of the rapid withdrawal of the slope. As we have previously seen, the field interest of applied geomorphology is the relationship established over time between geomorphic systems and humankind. Geomorphic systems provide essential resources for socio-economical development, such as landforms, deposits, and even some processes. A landform becomes a geomorphological resource only if it has a social implication, if it has a capacity load in a relation to various functions. Thus, the evaluation will first establish the existence of the landform, then the perception as a geomorphological asset, and as a consequence, the usage of possibility. Different kinds of deposits, such as alluvial, marine, coastal, glacial, slope deposits, are used for the production of concrete, for the construction of road and railways bed, for macadam and ballast preparation. In terms of processes, assessed as a geomorphological resource, we could mention weathering or the repeated floods in floodplains area, processes related with soil formation, essential in agriculture. Even so, the majority of geomorphological processes induced instability in the affected territories and become major threats for society, disturbing its activities. On the other hand, humankind, including population, buildings and structure, infrastructures, economic activity, social organization, and any other development program planned for an area, may be directly or indirectly responsible for changing the general trend evolution of the terrestrial relief. Geomorphological resources may be altered or destroyed, while some processes are triggered. In the long term, these actions may have a boomerang effect, re-entering into the cycle of geomorphological resources or hazards. To resume, the main objective of applied geomorphology is to provide scientific knowledge in order to design territorial planning strategies for an optimal development. Geomorphology can contribute to the public policy in understanding how human action will feedback changes into other natural system components. Scientific knowledge of the territory consists in the documentation about quality and potential of land for an appropriate use of conditions and phenomena related to relief, while development policy refers to the choice or decision upon a solution for a better use of space, and depend by the government work, public administration practices, consultancies, and so on. There are four types of work of geomorphology studies which can interface with policies, with development policies. Cataloging and inventories landforms, assessment of effect of human activities, prediction of effect of proposed activities, and development of policies and alternative strategies. Geomorphological involvement in different stages of policies consists in problem identification and strategy specification, and also policy formulation, implementation, and evaluation. Scientific knowledge from geomorphological point of view involves assessing the current status of relief, but also its relationship with the built environment, highlighting the sensitive areas in terms of conflict. Geomorphological research carried out to determine the optimal space for various economic and social activities due to the significance of relief in the architecture and dynamics of the environment. Comprehensive survey of geomorphological elements could lead to establish the restrictiveness or favorability of relief forms for specific human activities. The role of applied geomorphology studies consists in identifying and inventorying the landforms, deposits that may be involved in a development project. In the same time, geomorphological analysis includes also the surface dynamic imposed by different geomorphological processes, some potentially dangerous, and predict the effects of the proposed arrangement on the relief. That means that natural space must be examined in terms of geomorphological hazard, which may endanger a project, and of geomorphological assets, which may be damaged by the various extents of human activities. We can identify three categories of processes, three general categories of processes, such as weathering, who led to the different type of deposit, but not to the land, to specific landforms, mass movement, which conduct to a specific landforms deposit, and also threats, and erosion transport and deposition made by different environment, like water, air, ice, which conduct to landforms deposit and specific hazards. Thus, after having assessed the sustainability of the of a certain location, mainly with respect to its morphography and morphometry, the geomorphological hazards of the area, which may threaten the development project, must be considered. Relief contribute with the geometrical shape that imposed the type of the land use project, and also with the dynamic and conjunctural factors, which influence the way on which the project is implemented. Human activities may produce two other kinds of effects. First, refer to the consequence of geomorphological hazard induced by project on the project itself, that means direct risk, and on the surrounding areas, that means indirect risk. Second, takes into account the potential deterioration of geomorphological assets due to the hazard induced by project, that means indirect impact. Men can have, though, double significance. as he can trigger and increase the risk phenomenon, but also he can mitigate the risk effects. When we talk about the geomorphic system, susceptibility is the system predisposition for the certain specific internal reorganization mechanism, depending on the initial condition of system. Susceptibility indicates the possibility of a hazard occur. On the other hand, anthropic systems are characterized by the vulnerability, which is the extent to which a system exposed to a hazard can be affected, and it is identified as a potential internal dysfunctions. Vulnerability is related to the risk scale rate. To illustrate the connectivity between this, the content of these terms, we should analyze the definition given by Varnes in terms with landslide hazard, which is the probability of occurrence of a landslide with destructive potential in a certain area. And when we say that, we also already identify the susceptibility. And in some moment, and now we have the whole image of the hazard, which can generate and presume number of victims, injured person, damages and dysfunctioning of economical activities. And now we have the risk. So, susceptibility, define and evaluate the probability of occurrence in space, and is reflected by the questions where. Whereas hazard define and evaluate the probability of occurrence in space and in the same time in time, and is reflected by the questions where and when. Risk involves the hazard and defines the estimate the potential damages, and is reflected by the questions where, when, what or how many or much can be affected. Presume hazard is the possibility of occurrence of a natural or anthropogenic event with devastating effects in a certain time and in a certain space. Whereas risk reflects the potential damages and negative consequences as a result of a hazard. In other words, geomorphologists will generally be involved in mass movement problems at the identification and diagnosis stage, while engineers will have the main responsibility for designing amelioration methods and planners to ensure that risks are avoided. Returning to the goals, applied geomorphology have three main objectives: to analyze, to predict, and to draw a general picture of long-term tendency of evolution, of relief revolution. Applied geomorphology identifies and describes landforms and geomorphic processes, and also explain their origin and predict subsequent behavior on their evolution. So the first stage is analysis, which consists in identifying, describing, and explanation. The second phase consists in prediction, which means using the previous data to construct a model of evolution, and also to establish relief general tendency of evolution. In that way, Geomorphologists can be involved in various type of work, for example, policy, practice, problem solving, regulation, compliance, and design. Certain themes and areas of application of scientific geomorphological knowledge have long been prominent, including role of human impacts, natural hazards, resource use, planning of development and infrastructure. According to the main categories of land use, geomorphologists could be involved in different types of action, such as landscape design, soil erosion control and land degradation control, forestry engineering, hydrotechnical projects, urban planning, road engineering, tourism development, or hazard and risk assessment. Furthermore, I will show you some examples from Romania, but for a better understanding of its particularities, let's see the regional context of this national territory. As we can see, Romania is a country with a varied lithological structure made from metamorphic, sedimentary, and also magmatic or volcanic rocks. The morphometric parameters of the relief caused a local arrangement in concentrically tier steps. The relief is represented by a great diversity of landform, which lies to over 2,005 meter elevation. That features lead to a high instability of slopes. As we can see, more than 6% of the national territory it's included in the classes of medium high or high landslide hazards. Because of this, many development projects had confronted with the necessity of erosion slope control. Geomorphologists have to envisage and model the implication of geomorphic system by increasing the understanding of processes, dynamics, variability, and time and space scale of relief. One major problem is shown in this example of the most important highway of Romania, which crossed the country from southeast to northeast, and some particular sections are confronted with high landslide and other kind of erosion hazard. The major problem of this highway section is the fact that it crossed an area named Impossible Land, respectively, the two hills from Aciliu and Apoldu, as you can see in the image, Aciliu and Apoldu. These two clays, hills, have been known from centuries as areas with high instability, so they are uninhabited. Although excavation were built and the slope were terraced, as you can see in the image, the hills themselves were not reinforced with deep concrete anchors. Also, no efficient water collection works were carried out so that it would not reach to the ground and those would not cause new landslide. Maybe this is the reason of why this section is often affected by a large landslide. This image is from 2014, when the highway was under construction, but can appear anytime. Another example shows the instability of the slope that support a historical building site. The restoration of Suceava fortress involved landscaping work for parking lots, pedestrian and road access, rainwater and wastewater sewerage systems. Yet the slopes are still affected by erosion and small slippery surface. Another example, near to Oradea city on Ciuperca Hill, landscaping works were carried out during 2014 and 2015 for development of public garden. Improper technical solutions for the lithological and morphological conditions on the hill led to the onset of a deep landslide in November 2016, only 1 year after, as a result of a torrential rain, as it is shown in the next movie. And I will draw your attention to watch this short movie. As you can see, many landscape working were implemented in the recent past, but particularly this kind of works was the cause for the landslide in November 2016. Last year, the restoration of public garden began with groundwater and rainwater sewerage systems, removal of destroyed buildings, construction of drains, embankment and soil compaction works. Let's hope that that one will be more sustainable. Please allow me to remind that you have a question and answer section, so don't hesitate to use it. These examples reinforce the idea that applied geomorphological investigation are increasing in relevance as human involvement with a modification of natural landscape has become so sophisticated that man's activities now have a dominant impact on many places and landforms. In this respect, Coates has argued that geomorphologists are in a unique position to predict the type and amount of distortion that will occur when society chooses to alter natural landscape and processes. Geomorphological research relevance for decision making of public policy development includes land use development, agriculture improvement, water supply management, urban planning, impact of land use, slope stabilization, erosion control, reduction of geomorphological risk, mining and quarries exploration and exploitation, and also sustainable tourism. Applied geomorphologists working independently or serving on multidisciplinary advisory panels are well positioned to influence public policy to the benefit of society and the earth sciences. The role of applied geomorphology is to analyze the geomorphological resources, map the landforms and processes, understanding and control the effect of geomorphologic processes like weathering, landslide, rockfalls, lateral erosion, gully erosion, and so on, map and assess hazardous geomorphologic processes and their risk, propose the remedial measurement for reduction of these hazards, and also to provide geomorphological knowledge for territorial planning and environmental management. As we can see, applied geomorphological maps have been recognized as one of the main tools for land management planning and work scheduling from the perspective of both town planning and environmental protection. Such thematic maps showing the geological, geomorphological, hydrogeological, and the geoengineering territory features provide comprehensive and integrated representation of landforms, hydrographic networks, and shallow materials and their dynamics. They also provide useful information concerning the most appropriate studies and choices for monitoring and avoiding hazardous situations. The construction of map involved a preliminary documentation and map research. The inventory of applied geomorphological scientific notes and land planning tools. Applied geomorphological map show the territory's landform and processes, explain their origin and activity, the shallow material properties, and the main hydrologic characteristic. It is a useful tool for territory planning and management. Data management in a GIS environment allows us to develop a cartography tool that can be constantly updated and improved according to the result of studies, either punctual, like surveys, drillings, geophysical prospecting, or of more detailed area. GIS techniques allows the full range of subsurface data to be incorporated into the geomorphological interpretation and form the basis for creating three and four dimensional ground models. Starting with this idea that the fundamental skill applied by the geomorphologist is the map making, applied geomorphological map can be useful to develop new territorial planning projects or to improve the existing ones. Monitoring and evaluation of geomorphological resources based on a data collection is the first stage of a new development project design. Another example, also from the A1 highway, the most important of Romania, is the Pitești-Sibiu proposed section. Is a section under construction where the major challenges were to identify the most suitable route and find the most efficient technical solution to overcome the limitation imposed by the relief. The most sensitive sector is one which crossed the mountains, and it provokes the specialists to find a better solution, better technical solution, such as tunnels. Some researcher developed a new cartographic tools like geomorphotechnical map. Being a useful tool for relief analysis, the geomorphotechnical map is the new type of geomorphic map, a selective fusion of geomorphic data with land engineering and transport infrastructure features. This kind of map focuses on the interaction between landforms, morphodynamics, and transport infrastructure by reflecting the main favorable geomorphic conditions or limitations. We will take another example, also from infrastructure, from transport infrastructure, to identify problems and to see how can be solved related with the geomorphological hazards. This kind of problem identification and problem solving are based on data analysis in order to improve ongoing development projects. As we can see, in subcarpathian regions, landslides are most common. The National Road 73C is constructed for more than 90% on sloping surface. A wide variety of landslide types, a high landslide frequency, over 5 landslide reactivation per year, and other new are triggered, and a high density are the main characteristic of the slope instability along this national road. The main causes of landslide along this national road are hydrogeologically controlled and are linked to high degree of drainage density, but also the deforestation. The results highlighted considerable vulnerability of slope stabilization works as a consequence of an incomplete understanding of landslide processes and limited stabilization works involvement, just the road embankment. As we can see, applied geomorphology identifies and describes landforms and geomorphic processes, explain their origin, and predict subsequent behavior on their evolution. We applied those three objectives of applied geomorphology in the analysis of this particular case, 73C National Road. First of all, the first stage is to analysis consist in quantitative assessment of landforms and geomorphic processes. We applied methods like field survey and field mapping in different times in the recent past. The second phase is the quantitative estimation of morphometric parameters, which involves measurement and also GIS technique mapping. The third one is explanation, which evaluate the cause-effect relationship in the appearance on the and dynamic of landforms and geomorphic processes. We applied geophysical survey methods and also cross sections. Prediction determine the evolution trend in time and space of geomorphic processes or landforms based on some reliable dynamic series of data measurement of duration, rate, frequency, and spatial extension of the phenomenon. As we can see, for a sector of this national road, we can follow the changes of the configuration of the road. So in 2006, the new itinerary is affected only in the very small section by the landslide, but some years after, we see that the landslide, the area affected by landslide is increased. And a lot of part of this national road is affected. Postdiction is the assessment of landform features prior to the current situation. The evolution or history of the relief in the last part of the geological time, aspect which is related to the identification of the long-term trends of geomorphic phenomena studies. That could be helped to design the model of landslide evolution in order to apply the most reliable solution to control the instability of slope, but in reality that doesn't happen. That model wasn't used. The road is still vulnerable to the mass movement processes. Starting with this example, we can conclude that an efficient approach takes into account the following elements: the objectivity of the hazard assessment, the data source of general knowledge of the study area, the collecting data, the inventory sheet and database, and also the selection of analysis methods. The objectivity of evaluation of a hazard is ensured by rigorous measurement and exact calculation on geomorphological components. For reliable evaluation of a hazard, it is recommended to use numerous and varied sources of information in order to obtain the most complete data series. You can use previous studies, different kind of maps, aerial photographies, surveys, and also laboratory sampling. Data collection involves the use of several parameters or control factors analyzed in terms of their spatial variation. The ideal sampling units for mapping are the geomorphological units, since they are geohomogeneous and could be very precise determined as polygonal units. So using this kind of data, we can make thematic maps. Data collection and database creation is facilitated by the use of inventory sheets. This could be standardized and allow the systematic examination of each parameters or control factors. In terms of selected analysis methods, qualitative methods are based on inventory and mapping. Also, factors whose contribution to instability of slopes are estimated according to the level of knowledge and experience of the researcher. These methods are subjective and establish heuristic susceptibility and render their level using descriptive terms. So these methods are qualitative. Quantitative methods establish numerical estimates, such as the probabilities of occurrence of landslides. There are many categories of quantitative methods, such as statistical methods or deterministic methods, or even susceptibility index methods. Statistical methods describe the functional relationship existing between the stability or instability factors and the spatial distribution of the past and present landslide. Some probabilistic calculation models are Bayes theory or weight of evidence method, likelihood ratio, or certainty factors. Deterministic or geotechnical methods produce numerical estimates, for example, probabilities of occurrence of a slip phenomena in any susceptibility zone. Deterministic methods are based on the calculation of a slope stability factors, which represent the ratio of resistance and slip forces. The supra-unit values obtained by calculating these factors indicates a slope stability, while the subunit the opposite. Susceptibility index method, for example, could calculate slide index, gully erosion, or frequency index. Another example of this kind of quantitative methods is rapid impact assessment metrics. Was proposed and developed by Pastakia and Jensen in 1998. being a very flexible tool for environment impact assessment, this method allows selection of analysis components or indicators related to peculiar impact analysis area, subject or activity. These kind of components or indicators are scored from -3 to 4 according with the main criteria: importance of condition, which is factor A1, magnitude of effect or change, A2, permanence of effect or change, B1, reversibility of the process, B2, and cumulative effect, B3. Both criteria show the measure of impact from the chosen component, such as criterion A1 and A2 can individually change the score obtained, and criteria B1, B2, B3 should not individually be capable for changing the score. For comparing environmental scores, it is necessary to include into range of different types of impact. The selected analysis components which are affected by landslide are the following: local morphology as a road support, potential landslide, phreatic levels, forest and pastures, the general aspect of landscapes. The direct impact of landslide, anthropic prepared and triggered, is a new profile of slopes through the cracks, scarps, deformation. Landslides affects the original shape of the relief, local and irreversible. As we can see, the indirect effect occur on post-impact phases of the landslide as a result of the road construction work, such as repairing and consolidation of straightening of the road by executing backfilling and filling, either by excavation and leveling works. Landslides are distributed over the entire length of this national road, with a size between 100 and 2000 meters. Most intense impact has been considered being on the physical components of the natural environment. Some road rehabilitation solutions consist in position of curvature change of the road segments, some of them with negative impact on the road. Technical solutions for road development include excavation works, support works, planning topographical surface and drainage, leveling and filling, embankment cut and retaining walls, vertical drain, drainage ditch, gabion walls, piles works, and so on. The lack of interest in the stabilization works of slopes before rehabilitation road leads repeatedly to the damage of road. As we can see, some reconstruction works shows that the effect is maintained even after 10 years. Otherwise, the effect of the relationship between natural and anthropogenic environment along National Road 73C will be permanent if it doesn't work with the entire slope in order to stabilization all the slope. At this moment, I want to give the floor to my colleague who will demonstrate certain mapping techniques, terrain analysis and resources analysis using GIS tools. Just a moment to pass the role. And now, Andrea, you may take the link.
I guess I have volume. Okay. Thank you, Mihaela. Well, hello to you. And I have to say that I'm glad to know you in this way. And also, I'm glad to know that you are here with us in this online way. And you are interested about practical geomorphological aspects. To point out the information about applied geomorphology knowledge gathered during this course. Two short demonstrations we propose to show you and to follow. The first example of applied geomorphology regards the slope movements in the medieval inhabited citadel of Sighișoara. Why is it important to know how to assess the behavior of relief in relation with society impact? Why is it important to identify different patterns of this relation? It is important. It is important because it is a model of how the suitability of landform for defense and strategic fortress, which later has developed into one of the most well-known and continuously inhabited citadel for almost 8 centuries, derived into unsuitable factors. Thus, most of you are familiar with the fictional character Dracula or the historical character Vlad Țepeș. Today we show you, today we show you the place where he was born, this house, in Sighișoara Citadel, in this inhabited, look, the house where the Dracula was born 6 centuries ago. This citadel is included in UNESCO World Heritage, but also the geomorphic hazard and risk issues that the inhabited citadel has been facing for decades, at least annually, being destroyed slowly, we show you too. The demonstration is based on studies carried out over the years, and we want to show you how the landforms, fluvial terrace in this case, which were the foundation of the building of fortress in the Middle East centuries, by the military strategic role, given by the relief attributes as elevation, steep slopes, range of geographical isolation from the surrounding landforms. Nowadays, all these geomorphological parameters and factors contribute to the degradation of the historical walls and buildings of the Sighișoara Citadel on the background of an intensification of human activities like tourism, has a negative impact. So the walls and of the historical building and Sighișoara Citadel is threatening. The historical walls is are threatening by gravitational gravitational process, geomorphological process like such as landslide, earthfall, slip, natural and anthropical material, which are being the most common. This is the it was the short movie to have a big picture of the first example. Now let's begin to work a little in two type of soft which help us to mapping in and to mapping all this aspect. Thus, we started to apply the methodology which we'll reveal to you from the base maps. We looking for topographical, geological, touristic, hydrogeological, geotechnical maps or orthophoto plan. Orthophoto plans using GIS and generate an own geomorphological database. Here we have historical maps because we talk about historical site. In fact, this map is from 1898, and if you see the Sighișoara city is very small represented. We look forward to another historical map. In fact, I show you the same project in two different kind of software, QGIS, which is the open platform to digital cartography, and in ArcGIS map, an ArcMap, which is an S3 platform software. And in left side, on the left side of your screen, you can see the another type of map, which are more recently from 1953 year. And if you see the Sighișoara city is better represented. So we move on and we find another type of other types of base map which are more detailed at large scale, or we try to find also some orthophoto plans. This one are made it in 2010. And after that, just a second, I forgot, open source database are useful to this kind of project, and also are easy to use, but for small area often aren't updated. So we rely on the first base map and on the data collected from the field surveys. Maps, as you can see, reveal a lot of information. Different geographical aspects, geological elements, biogeographical elements, infrastructure, settlement, tourism aspect, cultural, social items. Creating your own database from georeference based map through vectorization of numerical and alphanumerical attributes of the inventory factors and parameters which are participate to the geomorphological risk exposure in risk analysis. Is the second step. Please permit to show you. No. Show you what try to tell you. There are four or five steps to proceed all the information, geomorphological, geological, and geographical information, and to achieve a very clear result. So, the first one was the acquisition of the base map. The second one was the georeferencing and vectorization. And the first step is the spatial. Spatial analyst. Spatial analyst of the geographical, geological, anthropogeographical parameters included in risk analysis. So a number of geomorphological or other type of factors and parameters in order to analyze this goal have been included in the risk analysis, either vector data or raster data. And the new layer of morphodynamic or morphometric, hydrodynamic, biogeographical, geological maps have been generated through their multi-criteria analysis. The next and finally step is the visualization, geo-visualization and making decision. This step is the link between geomorphology, applied geomorphology and society. Geo-visualization and making decision is in fact the applied geomorphology interface. Scientific, administrative, political, commercial, and cultural dissemination and making decision. Let's go to our exercises. In a case of a historical site, so I remember you, we decide to identify old maps in order to discover historical mass movement, like in this part. Okay, let's see. No, here. In this part and this one, we find different types of base map, such as historical maps or some topographical plans and one at 500. After a preliminary analysis of maps, we can identify some factor which probably have contributed to the geomorphological instability of historical site. This factor will be analyzed. Thus, the factors chosen in this example will be shown as vectors, data structure, such as elevation. Such as elevation map, name digital elevation model. We vectorize also the just a second. Also the land use using the polygons. I hope that you see. Choose to integrate the geomorphological processes, fillings, like, so geomorphological processes are this one, and the fillings, natural and anthropogenical fillings are this one. From this, our first maps, try to combine, to analyze, and generate another, such as from digital elevation model. We generate a simple map which describe the spatial distribution, to show the spatial distribution of the slope. Let me show you also the legend. And we generate also the aspect surfaces. I mean, so if the north, the shady surfaces, let's show also in ArcGIS, because we work in parallel way in the same time. Land use. Okay, the land use. Which describe, which show us the different type of functionality of the territory. It should be specified that other factor may be chosen. In our example, we choose 6 factors or parameters. Depending on the requirement of the this example, this study, and its objective. The spatial analysis, the morphometrical parameters like hypsometry, was generated, as I said, from a digital elevation model, which was interpreted. It will be edited depending on the requirements of the project terms, so as to display different hypsometric values into functional range in which elevation of the morphological surfaces have the same functionality and morphodynamic. The editing of digital elevation model will be done after a preliminary interpretation of the item listed above, and the result of this process will be this hypsometric map in raster, which is the raster data. The interval, the range of the hypsometrical maps are uneven, and the functional value. The slope map highlights the area with different potential and kinetic forces or energies, imposing different geomorphological process according to agree to degree, sorry, slope value in close relationship between geological support, landform, and human activity. The purpose of classifying the geogradient map or slope map is identify morphological area with different degrees of stability or instability. It is important to show you just a second slope and also the process. There is a good relationship between slope gradients and the process. As you see, we identified on a base map and on field survey a lot of incipient or old historical geomorphological processes like earth flow, like creeping, like real erosion, shallow landslide, slope fail, water supply, sewage, anthropogenical, other type of geomorphological processes. And regarding the slope map, it is important to interpret it, to analyze together these two factors. The aspect map. The aspect map shows those slopes categories which are homogeneous in terms of the amount of the solar radiation received by the topographical surfaces, and the way which may have different dynamics and very land use depending on this solar radiation received. Based on the classification of morphological surfaces shall comprise the following categories: in shady slope, semi-shady slope, semi-sunny and sunny slope, which are showed by the warm colors. And with green are show the shady and semi-shaded surfaces. Okay. The morphodynamic. The morphodynamic, just a second. The morphodynamic map show us the spatial distribution of the geomorphic process. In this stage, in this step, this map is a vector map. We translate it into a raster map because all the morphometrical maps are raster. One moment we will combine these maps and have to be in the same type. This map is complete through covering all area affected by geomorphological processes. A good a good interpretation of the topographic maps, and using also a maps of shading, we can appreciate. We can delimitate it. Sorry, the area with the same processes. We use also orthophoto plans, and yes, all the data collected from field survey. Land use. Land use is another factor. Which show us the level of the instability, which is determined by the type, by the intensity and frequency of human activities. As a result, all surfaces in this study area that have different functionality, which shall be mapped. Lithology. Lithology is another factor. Just a second. I don't see. I don't know why. Let me see. Something happened. Okay, this one. The lithology is the response of the geological strata to the action of external agent, and it is different because depending on the petrographical characteristics and mechanical characteristics, hydrogeological, structural, and tectonic properties of each lithological layer. So the different lithologies and fillings, because in this area at the surface of the relief are more the fillings that the natural rocks, natural lithology. And all of these were mapped. Were mapped after the survey measurements. The next step in our project is to reclassifying factors or parameters, including the risk exposure analysis. The reclassification of the parameters according to the danger of the each factor considered is to give score, natural positive numbers, I mean, to each range of each parameters itself that included by analysis. The score will highlight the degree of the danger of each category of each parameters, with reference to the objective of the study. I remind you that the objective of this study, of this example, is to establish the stability of historical building in Sighișoara Citadel. Let's see some types of reclassified maps. For example, we have the hypsometrical maps with functional ranges, and we score a lot each range, which is points from 1 to 3 or 4 or 5 points, and was generated apparently the same map, which has no measurement units measurements, and which show us with one the ranges which are more dangerous, most hazardous for historical citadel from elevation point of view. Two I see that the range, elevation range, which is show as 2, reveal that it is still dangerous for historical buildings, but not so dangerous that the previous one, and so on. So we can make this for all land or not one, for all factors. And if you see all factors reclassified has a range named 1, which means very dangerous, and 2, 3, 4, 5 depends of the decision, which means less dangerous than the previous ranges, and so on. If you see, we have the filling, anthropogenical and natural fillings, and the same map, which are reclassified. Sorry. Also, the processes was reclassified, and if in the vector source we have a lot of geomorphological processes, in the map which show us the danger of each geomorphological processes, we have just 5 ranges, 5 classes. Low value score will to conclude it, low value score will be awarded to those categories of high danger, which are the most important in triggering of the risk. The high values show us the less, the low danger, but it is important to imply in our risk analysis, because they are the preparing role. The result of reclassifying process are other spatial distribution, if you see, of degree of the danger maps for each factor analyzed. These new output maps will not have units measured. Land use, geological hazard, geomorphological process maps will first go to through a conversion process, I remind you, from vector to raster maps. Then they will also be given score in relation to the danger. These generated maps do not require to, in particular, to edit the legend after their generation. The method used for combining all these maps maybe consist either of a simple overlap, or either combination, or through application of the specific algorithm to calculate all the hazard values, which reveal by the factor or by the parameter reclassification maps included in risk analysis. We choose the simple way we applied the summarizing, the sum calculation, what it means that we overlap all the factors. So applied this simple algorithm, a new map was generated, this result will be, if you want, a good example of susceptibility map, or if you want, or exposure of risk at the peculiar geomorphological process. What is the peculiar geomorphological process in this case? You see, the most important contribution in geomorphology destroying the historical building of Sighișoara Citadel are the shallow landslide, which we see on purple color. So, if you see, we have with red all the area which are. I hope that you see with red the area with high danger for building. Let's see also the buildings. We overlap the other vector map, the legend can generally be edited in 3, 4, 5 categories to easily seen the very high danger and the very low danger to citadel historical site. The smallest value will correspond to the highest exposure to the geomorphological process analyzed, and the highest value will correspond to the lowest level of it. Inside of the inhabited historical area, the geomorphological and geological instability is rather low. Let's see again. With blue, there are those surfaces, geomorphological surfaces, which are not so in danger to be modulated by the actual geomorphological processes. In the center of the Sighișoara Citadel, there are no many exposure at risk surfaces. Where is a pronounced morphological and hydrogeological dynamic amplified in most cases by anthropogenic factors such as inadequate sewage or inadequate water supply system, pluvial sewage. The heritage edifices are characterized by a high vulnerability at the geomorphological processes, gravitational geomorphological processes, such as shallow landslide. In fact, in this part, at a very short time after we finalized this study, a whole part of a large part of the ancient walls, historical walls of the citadel was destroyed. It's very pity because it's a huge loss, but for us, from scientific point of view, for us was the symbol of the certain method. The heritage edifice in this part is characterized by the high vulnerability here in east part, in northeast part, and also in east part of Sighișoara Citadel, nearby the city hall, also nearby the shoemaker's tower, also here nearby the butcher towers. This is the first example which we wanted to show you. Please pay attention for the next poll. Then we will concentrate just for a few minutes on the second example. Mihaela? Mihaela, please activate. Okay.
The poll is now open, so you can proceed. There are 25 polls in progress, so you still have time, another 2 minutes, more or less. One more minute. And please try to finish because you have only 10 seconds for that. And now the poll is closed. So please, Andrea, you can continue with the second example.
Thank you, Mihaela. The second example, Poiana Brașov. Another type, approach of the applied geomorphology, for example, reveal the link between geomorphology and the tourist function of the territory. It's the same sketch, it's the same steps. The multi-criteria analysis leads to results concerning both of the environmental impact of tourist development and the feedback of environmental on tourism or infrastructure tourism are shown. As the previous exercise, using the same base types, topographical map, geological maps, land use, tourist maps, satellite images, images, vectors data of natural and anthropogenic parameters and factors that can be mapped in order to assess this relation. The factors chosen for risk assessment remain mainly the same in the previous example. What are we going to present in next minutes? We present an example of negative effects in time of human activities regarding the expansion of the ski area on the quality of the safety of winter touristic activities. In this winter season, until last week, mountain emergency rescue services has received over 400 emergency calls because of the ski accidents, meaning 423 of injured skiers were in need of medical care. we're going to analyze the relation between the undesirable events which involving emergency intervention and geomorphological processes that occur in winter season along the ski slopes of the most known ski resort from Romania, Poiana Brașov. Thus, we will introduce new factors such as the number of tourists which access the ski area and the number of dangerous skiers. We will focus on a small area of Poiana Brașov mountain resort. We follow the same steps of the analysis, meaning documentation and identification of the base map, vectorization of data collected of each factor considered for the proposal announced. Modeling the spatial variation of the spatial distribution of factors will bring us to the opportunity to relate the areas where the gravitational processes usually are triggered with the areas where the where often the skiers are hurt. Let me review the maps in the first two steps. After you can see the touristical maps of the Poiana Brașov ski resort. We return to ArcGIS software, and in few words, we review the maps which are chosen like such as base map, the topographical map, geological maps. We use also the orthophoto plan. Creating database and generating spatial distribution factor maps, we proceed to vectorizing. And using the contour level, we are able to understand the configuration, general configuration of the relief of the landscape, and to make a detailed analysis. It is important to follow the next steps. We vectorize the all infrastructure, touristical infrastructure, ski pist, special transport, etc. And after that, we proceed to make the digital elevation model, and through editing legend, we discover that there are five elevation ranges. The most important our goal will be the second range, 1000 and 1400, because in this part we see that there are a lot a high frequency of high density of ski pist also in this area. For a detailed understanding of what it what its occurrence and we will focus to interpretate also the slope map. Let's see the legend. Also the aspect. We know that the winter sports are related to the aspect geomorphological surfaces. The geomorphological, the variation of the geogradient surfaces highlights the area of the slope of with different of different dynamics in close relation with different types of lithology and land processes induce either natural and anthropogenical causes. Let's see the processes. If you see, there is a good relation between the processes and the area, red areas. The aspect map, the aspect map is a tool to assess this parameter in relation to the winter tourist activities on the one hand, and on the other hand for hazard processes. If you see that all the ski area is built on is arranged on shady slope and semi-shaded slopes. So in this map you can see just a second to in this map you can see two sedimentary rocks, two sedimentary rocks types with a high degree of cracking, prone to weathering, have been which have been inventoried to throughout to the ski area. And if we look the legend, we identify that a lot of part of ski area are overlap on limestone, and the other part on the conglomerates. In order to identify in which areas the skier are mostly exposed to injuries because of the gravitational geomorphological processes, all maps will were calculated to identify the susceptibility. But for this process, we have to calculate the susceptibility index, like frequency or density of geomorphological process or injured tourist. From all processes map, which were combined, final maps, which are this one, which is with this one, was mapped. The gravitational geomorphological process are the ones which are the most dangerous for skier. This information results from this map because small fragments of rocks falling and spreading out on the ski tracks, ski piste. In the very best situation, only the equipment remains affected, but often the skiers are hurt. So, what can resume? What did we do? We decide. We decide. We go. We decide who might be hurt. What skiers can be hurt by these processes. For this part of analyze, we needed to know the number of skiers. And for this one, we try to understand and to know how many skiers access at least one on the season the ski area, and we are interested just for the skiers who access. So it is important to know that the most, just a second, I want to make a little bit clear. To understand what means these lines. Okay. These lines, color lines, show us the number, the density of the skier which access the lower part of the resort and the higher part. In fact, for this example, the range of the value is the most hurted skiers was related with the with this map. Combining these maps with the accessing maps, we achieve the result with the number of injured. So, in order to relate this result with number of skiers, we introduce in the assessment matrix all skiers that access the ski area in a winter season, and we obtain a vulnerability map of skiers on ski slope at the gravitational geomorphic process. Let's see the final map. The final map show us the areas where the mostly accident here in the lower part of the ski area, and here in the highest part of the ski area. In fact, there is a real relation between geomorphological risk areas and the skier injured. Well, all we have to do in this moment, if we want to be sure about this, is to check the result achieved with the geographical reality. I mean, to go in the in field and check the real cases. If differences between these maps obtained here in today and the geographical reality identified on the field means then other variable, other factors or parameter need to be introduced in risk analysis. Now, please again, please pay attention to the next conclusion in next few minutes, which are the final part of this course. Mihaela, please.
Thank you, Andrea. So I will take the lead. As I mentioned before, Tricard firstly used the term of applied geomorphology. As we started our discussion with its definition, we decided to end with one of his quotes as well. Applied geomorphology should adopt, as appropriate, a curative attitude, advancing in its own solution to restore the compromised natural balance, or a preventive attitude, making forecast of the negative effects of human intervention. As we can see, applied geomorphology has a rapid expansion of application in real world problems and of a growing appreciation of value of geomorphological contribution and approach. Applied geomorphology has been recognized as a topic and components within geomorphology throughout the last 50 years. Much geomorphological research has the potential to be applied. The incidence.
Just a second. It's not saying anything.
Please, Andrea.
The presentation, it isn't visible.
I'm sorry. Just a moment. It seems that I forgot to share with you. Thank you, Andrea, for mentioning it.
Welcome.
Okay. Just a moment. So, all the evidence show a rapid expansion of application of geomorphology in real world problems. Also, the incidence of natural disasters has always been influential in environmental policies and practice, but the recent occurrence of major rivers and coastal floods has contributed to an accelerating change in thinking on how dynamic and active environments should be managed. Actual application of geomorphology leads through the policy, practice, or planning outcomes that contributes to sustainable environmental management. Overall, the greatest contribution of applied geomorphology has been to transform the way of thinking from one of controlling nature by hard structure to one of working with nature that requires and uses understanding of geomorphological processes, morphology, and dynamics to provide sustainable solution to problems of human impact and human interaction with the environment. And with all these words, I want to thank you and to invite you for the last time to complete a poll. In a second. And now the poll is open, so please proceed. It is the final feedback from you in the way to find out if this presentation responds to your expectation. Please try to finish because you have only 20 seconds more. And now the poll is closed. Thank you very much for your collaboration and being so kind to give us answers. As we mentioned at the beginning of the meetings, we try to manage the Q&A section, and we respond to all questions, I think, as I see. Let me check again. Hope it was this information. It will be useful for your educational training. And if you want to ask us something more, another info, you can contact us on email. Thank you very much, and. Hope to see you sometimes in real life. Have a good day. Bye bye.
Bye bye, and thank you.